The topic for this video is WebSocket. So far, the methods of communication between computers that we've discussed in the topics related to APIs have primarily been based on HTTP. With HTTP, especially those versions below HTTP 1.1, the client sends a request to the server, and in response, the server responds, creating a one-way communication. The only time a server sends a message to a client is in response to the client's request. While common functionalities can be implemented this way in a unidirectional manner, there are times when a different approach is needed. Let's think about a chat app. It is no problem for me to notify the server from the client when I send a message to the other person, but it's impossible for my app to detect when the other person sends a message. That's because in HTTP 1.1 and below, the server can't send a message without a request from the client. If you want to solve this problem using HTTP, there's a method called polling. The client periodically sends requests to the server to check if the other party has sent a new chat. The server immediately responds whether there is an update or not. There are two major problems with this method. Firstly, there can be a delay as much as the request period. It's not able to react immediately to the change in the server's status. The second is that unnecessary requests are continuously sent. If the request period is short, the response speed may be faster, but the waste of traffic will be more serious. Improvements to this include something called long polling. In long polling, the server does not immediately respond to the client's request, but waits until an update occurs. Then, when the other person sends a chat or a set time period expires, it sends a response, and the client sends another request waiting for the next response. Using this method, the speed at which it reacts to data updates is faster, but it results in more load on the server. The server maintains the connection with the client from the time it receives a request till it sends a response. If multiple clients are using the service at the same time, it has to maintain the same amount of connections, which can cause a load. This can also result in slower reactions to updates. The amount of header information included in HTTP requests and responses also acts as a burden each time. Therefore, in order to implement such a service properly, the client and server need to be able to exchange messages equally. In other words, a method that allows bidirectional communication is necessary. That's right, the WebSocket we are going to talk about today. If HTTP 1.1 is a method where the client sends a request like a letter and the server only responds, WebSocket can be described as a phone call where both parties can freely exchange conversations.
Hold on, in the gRPC video last time, you said HTTP 2 was like a telephone conversation. So, are WebSockets similar to HTTP 2?
If we were to compare these three, HTTP 2 could be likened to a limited call from a payphone booth, and WebSockets to a free call through a smartphone. HTTP 2 was not designed for long-term bidirectional communications like this chat app. It is possible for the server to send a push, but this is part of the response to the client's initial request. Regular requests and responses are also needed to maintain the connection, especially there are still many restrictions in using it in the browser. We'll cover the details about HTTP 2 in subsequent videos related to HTTP or protocols. The process of WebSocket communication works like this. The client sends a request to connect the WebSocket to the server through HTTP. It's like sending a letter proposing to communicate over the phone. If possible, the server will send a response to accept this request, also via HTTP. This process is called a handshake. Once connected, the client and server will start communicating using WebSocket protocol, not HTTP. This is when the phone call begins. Here, the client and server can freely send messages to each other. Communication in WebSocket is more efficient than HTTP because the size of the header is small and it has less overhead. This phone conversation continues until one party sends a message to close the call. When one side sends a close frame, the other side confirms it and responds with a close frame as well, ending the connection.
What if the client's phone is out of battery and turns off before it can send the close frame?
There are ways to detect abnormal disconnections. Sending a confirmation packet when there has been no message for a specified period of time is one way, and periodically exchanging ping and pong frames to confirm each other's connectivity is another way. A WebSocket keeps one connection open all the way, using minimal resources in the process, so it doesn't put as much load on the server as long polling. With this WebSocket, you can efficiently build services that need real-time updates from the server, like chat apps. Let's delve a bit deeper into the handshake process we talked about earlier. The client's request includes this type of information in its header. You may remember I compared the header to a shipping label from the RESTful API video. This part means upgrading the current HTTP connection to the WebSocket protocol. It's like suggesting, let's talk on the phone from now on. The SEC WebSocket key contains a string that has been Base64 encoded, which the client generates randomly. Upon receiving this request, the server calculates the SHA1 hash after appending what we call a GID, a preset string, to that key, and then encodes it back into Base64. For those of you who don't know what this means, you can think of it as transforming the above string into the below string using a formula that everyone knows. The server sends this value back to the client in the header. The client then checks if this value originated from the key it sent. As I told you, because it's a formula known to everyone, the client can also confirm that the server has processed the correct key. With this, the client can verify that the response came from the person they sent the request to. From this point, both are free to communicate bidirectionally, until one side sends a close call and the other responds to it.
So what's the relationship between this WebSocket and TCP sockets and UDP sockets that we learn in Java? They're all sockets, so are they the same?
They belong to different levels of the OSI 7 layer. TCP and UDP sockets operate in the transport layer, layer 4, while WebSocket operates in the application layer, layer 7. We will cover the OSI 7 layer in more depth later, but you can think of the lower layers as closer to hardware and the higher layers as closer to software. WebSocket operates based on TCP sockets. Because WebSocket communication uses TCP, the order and reliability of the data is guaranteed. Thanks to these advantages, WebSocket is used in many fields where real-time two-way communication is needed, not only in chat apps, but also in online games, stock-related apps, collaboration tools, location tracking, and so on. However, there are limitations and parts that need to be addressed in this WebSocket. First, the implementation can become complex depending on the server's design. Especially in servers where load balancing is applied, there are many parts to consider and set for this.
Isn't this load balancing thing like a bank teller window where many servers divide and take client requests?
Right, because WebSocket communication only takes place within a constant connection to a specific server. Once you start WebSocket communication with a server, it needs to be set so that data is continuously sent only to that server. You can find and solve the method suitable for the service by selecting a load balancer that can handle WebSockets, such as NGINX, JPROXY, AWS, ELB, and so on. Another consideration is that the size of the message is limited. Depending on the browser, server, and network environment, there can be constraints on the size of the message in WebSocket. For large amounts of data, you can use methods such as sending them in separate parts or using different protocols. Plus, the default protocol for WebSocket, WS, is not encrypted. Therefore, if it's a service where security is important, you need to apply for an SSL TLS certificate and use it to set up WSS. This is the same as the process of applying HTTPS, which will be covered separately in another video later.
There's a mountain of videos that need to be made.
Lastly, it's a lot less onerous than methods like polling, but WebSocket can still put a strain on the server. The more users that are connected at the same time, the more TCP connections need to be maintained, and if messages are being sent and received frequently, that can also increase the use of network bandwidth and CPU. Therefore, if these problems occur in the service you want to implement, you need to consider whether WebSocket is the best choice. In the next video, we'll look at alternatives to WebSocket, depending on the characteristics of the service. See you in the next video. Thank you.